Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. There are any number of narrations from Ayesha that indicate that Ayesha was happy to hear that Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam had been murdered. And this implies that Ayesha disliked Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam. The author of Maqatil al-Talibiyin is Abu al-Faraj al-Isfahani. He's a historian of the early Islamic era when it was the time of compiling hadith and compiling history. In the book of Tarikh Madinat al-Salam by Ahmad Abu Bakr al-Khatib al-Baghdadi, which is a very important book of the biographies of the narrators of hadith. This is volume number 13 of the book, published by Dar al-Gharb al-Islami at the year 2001, page number 337, biography number 6231, Ali ibn al-Husayn, ibn Fulan, Abu al-Faraj al-Umawi al-Katib. He's from Bani Umayyah, and his kunya is Abu al-Faraj, and he is known as Isfahani, Abu al-Faraj al-Isfahani. Wa kana aliman bi ayyam al-nas. He was a man of great knowledge of the history, Ansab, genealogy, seerah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa kana sha'iran muhsina, and himself was a decent poet. Wal ghalibu alayhi riwayatul akhbari wal adab, and mostly he narrated events of history and etiquettes of Arab. And he authored a number of books, amongst them is the book of Maqatil al-Talibiyin, the books of how important personalities of the children and progeny of Abu Talib alayhi salam were killed. So such as Ja'far ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam, who was murdered, who was killed, martyred in the Battle of Mu'tah, and Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, Imam Hassan alayhi salam, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, and other progeny of Abu Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. He narrates at the bottom of the page, next page, وكان أبو الحسن البتي يقول لم يكن أحد أوثق من أبي الفرج الإصفهاني. أبو الحسن البتي says that he was a very reliable person, أبو الفرج الإصفهاني. There was no one more reliable than him. This is his book مقاتل الطالبيين, the book of مقتل, not just of one person, but the events of the blood of the children and progeny of Abu Talib alayhi salatu wassalam. Published by Manshurat al-Mu'assisat al-Alami in Beirut at the year 2006. Let's go to page number 55. Lamma ata Aishata na'yu aliyan amir al-mu'minin alayhi salatu wassalam. Let's go to the middle of the page first. An Abil Bakhtari qal lamma anja Aishata قَتْلُوا عَلِيًّا عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ سَجَدَتْ. When Aisha heard about that Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam has been killed, has been slain, Aisha made a sajda out of gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this, obviously, nobody does that except if she were an enemy of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. Top of the page. لَمَّا أَتَى عَائِشَةَ نَعْيُ عَلِيًّا أَمِيرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. When the news of the martyrdom of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam reached Aisha, tamathalat, she expressed an Arabic proverb, an Arabic poem that's a proverb that indicates gaiety and happiness and pleasure. فَأَلْقَتْ أَصَاهَا وَاسْتَقَرَّتْ بِهَا النَّوَى كَمَا قَرَّ عَيْنًا بِالْإِيَابِ الْمُسَافِرُ. This is the story of a woman. This woman before Islam, it's where her story that this woman would get married time and again. And whenever she got married, she was not happy. She would never be happy with a husband. And the sign of her, this is just an Arabic mythology, maybe it's true, maybe it's not, but this is what the poem refers to, a woman before Islam. Whenever she got married, she would dislike her husband. And she would never take off her headscarf. So Asa is the headscarf. Until she married the right person. When she married the right person, she dropped her headscarf. So that's the meaning of the poem. فَأَلْقَتْ أَسَاهَا. She was happy. أَلْقَتْ أَسَاهَا. She dropped her headscarf. She said that I'm going to live here now. This is my home. وَاسْتَقَرَّتْ بِهَا النَّوَى. Now, النَّوَى means distance. Distance. To be far away. And no more she was distant, no more she was far away, she felt at home. كما قر عينا بالإياب المسافر. As when a traveler returns home, he becomes overwhelmed with joy. With joy. So she dropped her scarf and she was no longer at a distant place, at a stranger place. She felt home. As if when a musafir, as if a traveler just got home. How happy would be she? He would be. She felt happy like that. So this is a proverb of the Arabs that indicate happiness and gaiety. And this is not my translation, and this is not my assertion only. Great scholars of Arabic literature have mentioned that. Let's have a look at these books. Kitab al-Ayn li Abi Abd al-Rahman Khalil ibn Ahmad al-Farahidi, the most respected and the oldest book of lexicography in the Arabic language. Khalil ibn Ahmad died at year 175. Al-Juz al-Thani, volume number 2. Page number 197, the meaning of word asa. وَإِذَا انْتَهَى الْمُسَافِرُ إِلَىٰ عُشْبٍ وَأَزْمَعَ الْمُقَامِ قِيلَ عَلْقَى عَصَاهُ. When a musafir, when a traveler reaches a green pasture, and he decides to stay in that green pasture because the desert is dry and there's nothing for grazing camels or anything. But when he reaches a green pasture, he wants to stay there. It says, Alqa asa. He dropped his scarf to stay there. Qala fa'alqat sha'ir. Poet has said, fa'alqat asaha wa istaqarrat biha an-nawa kama qarra 'aynan bil iyabil musafiru wa dhahaba hadha al-baytu mathalan. This poem, these two lines, this stanza, has become a proverb. This has become a short saying that has great meaning. مَثَلًا لِكُلِّ مَنْ وَافَقَهُ شَيْءٌ فَأَقَامَ عَلَيْهِ. For any person who encounters a pleasant event and wants to enjoy that new situation. وَكَانَتْ, and this is this وكانت هذه امرأة, and this poem is about a woman. كلما تزوجت فارقت زوجها. She married many times, and every time she would get married, she would divorce her husband. ثم أقامت على زوج. Then finally, she found the right husband and stayed with him. وكانت علامة إبائها أنها لا تكشف عن رأسها. The sign that she is not happy with a new husband was that she would never drop her headscarf. فَلَمَّا رَضِيَتْ بِالزَّوْجِ الْأَخِيرِ. When she was happy, finally she found the right husband and she was happy with him. أَلْقَتْ عَصَاهَا أَيْ خِمَارَهَا. She dropped her headscarf, and that was a sign that she was happy. And that's why this became a proverb. فَأَلْقَتْ عَصَاهَا. أَلْقَتْ عَصَاهَا. She dropped her headscarf. It means that you encountered a situation which is very pleasant, that you wished for. المحكم والمحيط الأعظم في اللغة. تاليف علي بن إسماعيل بن السيدة. الجزء الثاني. Page 215. وألقى المسافر عصاه إذا بلغ موضعه وأقامه. When a person who is traveling, he drops his scarf, it means that he reached a place where he wants to stay. لأنه إذا بلغ ذلك ألقاه فخيم وقام. Because when he reaches that place that he wants to stay, he's going to throw down his scarf and he's going to make himself a tent and he's going to stay there. And then he mentioned the story of that woman. And then وَيُضْرَبُهَا, then he mentions this poem, فَأَلْقَدْ أَصَاهَا, the same poem that Aisha read. Aisha recited when she learned that Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam has been killed. فَأَلْقَدْ أَصْحَاهَا وَاسْتَقَرَّتْ بِهَا النَّوَى كَمَا قَرَّتْ عَيْنًا بِالْإِيَابِ الْمُسَافِرُ وَيُضْرَبُ هَذَا مَثَلًا لِكُلِّ مَنْ وَافَقَهُ شَيْءٌ فَأَقَامَ عَلَيْهِ. This is a dictum, an aphorism, a terse saying that describes a greater truth. This is a proverb. This has a proverbial meaning. For every situation, when a person finds a situation very pleasing, and he wants that situation to continue. Let's go to the next book, كتاب الزهر الأكمي في الأمثال والحكم للحسن اليوسي. This book is also an encyclopedia of Arabic proverbs and Arabic maxims and Arabic aphorisms, published in year 1981. فألقد أصاها واستقرت بها النوى كما قر عينا بالإياب المسافر. قيل كان ليزيد بن عبد الملك يقول. يزيد بن عبد الملك, who was one of the caliphs of Bani Marwan of the first century, at the end of first century. When he became caliph after his father عبد الملك بن مروان, ما يقر عيني بما أوتيت من الخلافة. He would say that I'm not happy. Although I have become king and caliph, I'm not happy until I get these two concubines. حتى أشتري سلامة وحبابة. سلامة and حبابة were two female concubines. They were slaves and they were owned by somebody else, by somebody in Hijaz. حتى أشتريتا له. Until these two concubines were purchased for him. فلما اجتمعتا في ملكه قال أنا اليوم كما قال شاعر. He became so happy, he said, today is my day, as the poet has said. فألقد أصاها, the same poem that Aisha recited when Amir al-Mu'mineen عليه الصلاة والسلام was murdered. فألقد أصاها واستقر بها النوى. She dropped her headscarf and she felt at home, as if a traveler has returned home and he's overjoyous and he's overwhelmed with happiness. I'm like that person. And then he mentions a number of other occasions that dropping the headscarf, that's what it means in the Arabic, classic Arabic. It means, it indicates a situation of pleasure, a situation that's ideal, that you were wishing for, and suddenly it was acquired. والعرب ضربت المثل بإلقاء العصا في الاستقرار والراحة من الأسفار. The Arabs used to use dropping the headscarf as a proverb to become to settle down and become comfortable after long and exhausting travels. Okay. كتاب تهذيب اللغة لأبي منصور محمد بن أحمد الأزهري, volume number 3, one of the classic scholars of Arabic literature. تهذيب اللغة by Azhari, volume number 3, published in مطابع سجل العرب. Page number 77. قيل للرجل إذا أقام بالمكان واطمأن واجتمع إليه أمر قد ألقى عصاه. A person, when he settles down in his place and he becomes confident and all his loose ends are tied up and his affairs are in order, ألقَى عصاه, he dropped his scarf. Okay, let's go to the next book. كتاب مفيد العموم ومبيد الهموم لأبي بكر الخوارزمي, published in 1906 in Misr, in Egypt. الباب السابع في من طلب الملك ولم ينل. People who sought to be rulers, but they never reached rulership. There are a number of people in history, of course, who wanted to be rulers, kings, and they couldn't become kings. One of them was Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn al-Hasan, and he was considered to be a Mahdi by the Zaydis, and he was the person who was supposed to become Khalifa when Bani Abbas rose. Let me tell you a brief history of Bani Abbas. Bani Abbas, their first caliph is As-Saffah, Their second caliph is Mansur. And Saffah became caliph around 132 to be more precise, 132. He defeated the Bani Umayyas and in Syria, the final battle, major battle, and took over Damascus at year 132. But they were nobodies. Bani Abbas, children of Bani Abbas, were nobody. And Bani Umayyah were very strong, very powerful. However, Bani Abbas, what they did, they aligned themselves with muhaddithin, great muhaddithin and fuqaha of Iraq. And they used to travel from town to town. Mansur and his brothers, Abbas and Ibrahim al-Imam, there was another. They had a great bigger brother, Ibrahim al-Imam. And he was supposed to be Khalifa. Ibrahim was supposed to be Khalifa, not Saffah. However, Saffah became Khalifa because Ibrahim died first. At any rate, they used to travel from town to town and they were telling people that we are from Ahlul Bayt. And they would tell people about fada'il of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. And they would say, we want to raise an army against whom? Against Bani Umayyah. And we are going to return Khilafah to Ahlul Bayt. And they had secretly done bay'ah. Bani Abbas, all of them had secretly bay'ah to Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn al-Hasan. As had done Abu Hanifa, Malik ibn Anas, major fuqaha of the Umaris, they had done Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn al-Hasan. So Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn al-Hasan was supposed to become Khalifa. But that's not how it worked out. Saffah and Mansur and all them, they went to Khurasan. They went to present-day Afghanistan and Iran, eastern Iran and Afghanistan and Turkmenistan. And they gathered people and they were able to raise an army under the leadership and command of Abu Muslim al-Khurasani. Abu Muslim was a very intelligent and a very capable and a very bold military man. And he was able to bring an army and defeat the Bani Umayyads. And of course, Saffah became Khalifa. And they did not hold their bay'ah. They had done bay'ah. With whom? With Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn al-Hasan. But they did not stay with their bay'ah. And Saffah became Khalifa. And this was all obviously. They violated their Pledge of Allegiance. And Umari Fuqaha, such as Malik ibn Anas, Abu Hanifa, they stayed until the end, true to their bay'ah, to Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn al-Hasan, who was from the children of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salatu wasalam. Later, because Abu Muslim was a very capable general and he commanded the respect of the Khurasanis, who were the backbone of the power of Bani Abbas, Saffah, when Saffah died, Mansur the second caliph from Bani Abbas, he became very, very jealous of Abu Muslim. And he decided to kill Abu Muslim. And Abu Muslim was not a good person. He was a capable general, but he was not a good Muslim. We Shias do not see him in a good light. At any rate. So he conspired. He summoned Abu Muslim to his court. And he had put his slaves, his servants, with swords, and he made a pact with them that when I touch my beard, it means that you attack Abu Muslim and kill him. So when Abu Muslim came, he had a conversation with Abu Muslim. He said, Abu Muslim, he told Abu Muslim that you are my enemy, and you did this and this and this and this, and he touched his beard, and then they came and killed Abu Muslim. And they took cut off his head. They threw his head out to the army, so the army knows that Abu Muslim is dead. Nobody should fear him anymore. Nobody, his supporters, they should not think of trying to make a rebellion or try to free him up or anything. And he gave some money also to supporters, the soldiers who were with Abu Muslim, so there wouldn't be any rebellion in the army. And he wrapped the body of Abu Muslim in a blanket and put it there on the floor. On the other hand, Muhammad ibn Abdullah, ibn al-Hasan, the so-called Mahdi of the Zaydis, he rose up against Mansur with an army in Medina. He made a rebellion that I'm the true caliph. Who are you? Who are you? I was supposed, you did bay'ah to me. You were supposed to be my subject. I was supposed to be the king. So he led an army, a rebellion against Mansur and Medina, and Mansur was able to defeat him and kill him. When he was killed, and he had a brother, his brother's name was Muhammad ibn Abdullah, had a brother, Ibrahim ibn Abdullah. Ibrahim made a rebellion in Basra around 149, year 49, 148, something like that, Hijri, 148 or 49. And then he was killed and defeated in Basra. And when these people were killed, Mansur became so happy because most of his rebellion was defeated, right? That's when he recited this poem, فَأَلْقَدْ أَصَاهَا. Al-Qad Asaha. He dropped his head scarf. I've reached my dream now. Al-Qad Asaha. Bali. Wastaqarra biha an-nawa. Let's have a look at the book. Kitabu Mufidul Ulum wa Mubidul Humum Ta'alifu Shaykh Al-Alim Al-Allama Abi Bakr Al-Khawarizmi. Published in year 1906 in Misr, Egypt. Page number 322. Those who sought to be rulers, but they never became rulers. Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn al-Hasan ibn Ali, kharaj bil Madina. Muhammad ibn Abdullah, who was from the progeny of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam, and Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, told him not to rise up, but they did not listen, and they said, we are Imam, and nastajiru billah, they claimed Imamah. And they thought Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam was being jealous or something. At any rate, they rose up in Medina, fi askar in Jarrar, with a very powerful and well-armed army. فَقَتَلَهُ al-Mansur. Mansur killed him. Mansur defeated him. وَخَرَجَ أَخُوهُ بِالْبَصْرَى. His brother Ibrahim, he made a rebellion in Basra. فَاجْتَمَ عَلَيْهِ 60,000 مُقَاتِلٍ. And he was able to have 60,000, an army of 60,000 soldiers. فَأَسَابَهُ سَهْمٌ فَقُتِلْ. He was struck by an arrow and he died. وَحُمِلَ رَأْسُهُ إِلَى الْمَنْصُورِ. His head was carried to Mansur, Mansur al-Dawaniqi. فَتَمَثَّلَ شَعْرٌ. Mansur recited this شعر, this stanza. فَأَلْقَدْ أَصَاهَا وَاسْتَقَرَّ بِهَا النَّوَى كَمَا قَرَّ عَيْنًا بِالْإِيَابِ الْمُسَافِرِ. Mansur was so happy to hear that he said, this is my dream come true. My enemies have been killed. Abdullah, Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn al-Hasan in Medina and his brother in Basra. And with regard to Mansur, let's have a look. Abu Muslim al-Khurasani, look at this book. من الجزء الأول من كتابه حياة حيوان الكبرى. حياة حيوان الكبرى by كمال الدين الدميري. Page number 7. قال ابن خلكان في ترجمته. ابن خلكان in the وفيات الأعيان, the author of وفيات الأعيان. He has mentioned, كان أبو العباس السفاح شديد التعظيم لأبي مسلم. The first ruler of Bani Abbas, Safah. He respected Mansur greatly. My apologies. He respected Abu Muslim greatly. Abu Muslim. However, Mansur was very, very suspicious. Mansur, the second caliph, was very suspicious of Abu Muslim. So he had him killed with the story that I told you. بل فدخل على المنصور جعفر بن حنظلة فرأى أبو مسلم في البساط. So when Mansur touched his beard and his servants and slaves and his soldiers and his guards, they attacked and descended upon Abu Muslim and killed him and cut off his head and wrapped his body in a blanket. At that time, when his body is inside the blanket, as the king is sitting on his throne, Ja'far ibn Hanzala, he entered upon Mansur. He went to Mansur. When he saw that, he said, فَقَالَ يَا أَمِيرَ الْفَاسِقِينَ عُدْ هَذَا الْيَوْمَ أَوَّلَ خِلَافَتِكَ عُدْ هَذَا الْيَوْمَ أَوَّلَ خِلَافَتِكَ He said, يَا أَمِيرَ الْفَاسِقِينَ Consider this day, the first day, consider today, the first day of your caliphate. Because this person, who was really strong, this general Abu Muslim, who had probably his own plans to become a king, you were able to liquidate him and take him out. Consider the first day of your khilafah. فَأَنْشَدَ الْمَنْصُورُ مُتَمَثِّلًا At that time, immediately Mansur recited this verse. فَأَلْقَدْ عَصَاهَا وَاسْتَقَرَّ بِهَا النَّوَى She dropped her headscarf and she felt at home. She is no longer distant in a stranger lands. كَمَا قَرَّ عَيْنًا بِالْإِيَابِ الْمُسَافِرُ As a traveler is overwhelmed with joy when he comes back home. So, the same poem that Aisha recited when she heard that Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam has been murdered, these kings recited them when their enemies were killed, because this signifies happiness, pleasure, and a dream come true. Kitabu nihayatul arabi fi funun al-adab ta'lifun nuwayri A book in Arabic literature, volume number 5, published by Dar al-Kutub al-Alimiyyah. Page number 59. Yazid ibn Abd al-Malik would say, the story of Hababa, who was a concubine. Yazid ibn Abd al-Malik, she was very beautiful and she was very good looking. And the new king was very, very much infatuated with her. Yazid ibn Abd al-Malik would say, I have become king, but I'm not happy. Until Ashtariya Salamata Jariyata Mus'ab ibn Sulaym. Until I purchase Salama, the concubine of Mus'ab ibn Sulaym, and Hababa, the concubine of Ibn Lahiq al-Makkiyah. So he sent someone, and those two concubines were purchased for him. And when both of those concubines were in his possession, he recited this verse, this poem, فَأَلْقَدْ أَصَاهَا, the same poem that Aisha recited. This is again Nihayatul Adab, Arab fi Funul al Adab, but volume number 25. The previous one was volume number 5. This is volume number 25. تَبْعُ مَنْشُرَاتِ مُحَمَّدَ لِبَيْذُونَ دَارُ الْكُتَبِ الْعِلْمِيَّةِ Page number 28, the rise and rebellion of Ibrahim ibn Abdullah ibn al-Hasan ibn al-Hasan. Ibrahim ibn Abdullah. Ibrahim was the brother of whom? Muhammad ibn Abdullah. Muhammad ibn Abdullah is the son of Hassan, and Hassan is the son of al-Imam al-Mujtaba alayhi salatu wasalam. This Hassan is called al-Hassan ibn al-Hassan, is Hassan al-Muthanna. His son is Muhammad. His son is Abdullah. And his son is, he has two sons, Muhammad, and other son is Ibrahim. And Al-Hasan al-Muthanna is the son of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam, and he is the father. Hassan al-Imam al-Hassan al-Muthanna is father of Abdullah. Abdullah is father of Muhammad and Ibrahim. Ibrahim rebelled where? In Basra. Basra, Iraq, southern Iraq. Around 149. Had about 60,000 soldiers. And he mentions the story. And then when he was killed, Bali. بلغ المنصور الخبر بهزيمته أصحابه أولا فعزم على الاتيان الري. Mansur learned in Baghdad. Mansur learned that his army has been defeated in Basra. So he decided to run away. Mansur said, Abdullah ibn al-Hassan, I'm sorry, Ibrahim ibn Abdullah is coming after me. So he decided to make a run towards where? Towards Ray, towards Khurasan, towards Iran, towards Persia, towards Tehran. Then his astrologer said, no, don't go, don't run away. Ibrahim will be killed. But he didn't believe him. So he decided to run. At that time, the news arrived that Ibrahim has been killed. He was ready to run away. فَأَلْقَدْ أَصَاهَا. At that time, he recited this poem. فَأَلْقَدْ أَصَاهَا وَاسْتَقَرَّ بِهَا النَّوَى. He became so happy that enemy, Ibrahim, who was about to vacate Baghdad and leave and run away. He was to leave his khilafah because he had accepted his defeat. He has been killed, so he became very happy. The same poem that Aisha recited when she heard that Amirul Mu'minin alayhi salatu wasalam has been killed. This is the book of Tariqh al-Tabari. Now I show you many accounts that Aisha indeed recited that poem. Tariqh al-Tabari al-Juz al-Khamis, volume number 5, published in Darul Ma'arif in Egypt. Volume number 5, published in Darul Ma'arif in Egypt, yeah. Page 150. وَلَمَّا انْتَهَى إِلَىٰ آيشَةَ قَتْلُ عَلِيٍّ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قَالَتْ فَأَلْقَدْ أَصَاهَا وَاسْتَقَرَّتْ بِهَا النَّوَىٰ كَمَا قَرَّ عَيْنًا بِالْإِيَابِ الْمُسَافِرُ. When the news reached Aisha that Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam has been murdered, so she recited this poem. That's a proverb to indicate happiness, pleasure, and very, very wishful state that has come true, a dream that has come true. Translation of Tariqh al-Tabari, translated by G.R. Hotting, volume number 17, The First Civil War. History of al-Tabari, translated by G.R. Hotting, State University of New York Press. Page number 224. When the news of death of Ali alayhi salatu wassalam, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, reached Aisha, she said, and she threw down her staff. It's not a staff, it's a scarf. Asa means a scarf. This doesn't mean a stick here. It means a scarf. And settled upon her place of abode. She felt home. Like the travel, happy to return home. Footnote number 899. The verse is a proverbial. The verse is proverbial and is cited to indicate pleasure at something. See that? This proverbial and is cited to indicate it, to indicate pleasure at something. Alhamdulillah, it became very clear. Okay. Now let's go to the next book. At-Tabaqat al-Kubra ibn Sa'd, al-Mujallad al-Thalith, published by Dar al-Sadr Beirut, page number 40. قالوا وذهب بقتل علي عليه السلام إلى الحجاز سفيان بن أمية ابن أبي سفيان ابن أمية ابن عبد الشمس. The news of martyrdom of Amir al-Mu'minin عليه الصلاة والسلام reached Hijaz, reached Medina by this person, by this messenger, سفيان ابن أمية ابن أبي سفيان. فبلغ ذلك عائشة. Aisha heard that Amir al-Mu'minin عليه الصلاة والسلام has been murdered. فقالت, she said, she recited this poem, which indicates pleasure and happiness. كتاب جمل من أنساب الأشراف by أحمد بن يحيى البلاذري, volume number 3, published in Dar al-Fikr in year 1996, page number 263. ومضى إلى الحجاز بمقتل علي سفيان بن أمية. سفيان بن أمية brought the news of the martyrdom of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam to Mecca in Medina, Hijaz region. فَلَمَّا وَلَا يَنْعِي, and he was not sad about it. فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ عَائِشَةَ خَبَّرَهُ, when فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ عَائِشَةَ خَبَرُهُ أَنْشَدَتْ قَوْلَ الْبَارِقِي, when Aisha heard of the news of the martyrdom of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam, she repeated this poem by Al-Bariqi, the same poem that I've shown you time and again. فَأَلْقَدْ أَصَاهَا وَاسْتَقَرَّتْ بِهَا النَّوَى كَمَا قَرَّ عَيْنًا بِالْإِيَابِ الْمُسَافِرُ. So all the, and many and many other books of history, have they have all chronicled this act by Aisha, that she expressed extreme pleasure and gaiety when Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wassalam was killed. This is the book of Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal, volume number 41, published year 1421, hadith number 24,820, and the commentators say Isnaduhu Sahihun ala Sharti Muslim. The chain of narration is reliable and authentic, in par with the ahadith of Sahih Muslim. What is the hadith? Ata ibn Yasar says, جاء رجل, a man came, فوقع في علي وفي عمار رضي الله تعالى عنهما عند عائشة. A certain man came and he abused, verbally abused, he used bad words and he condemned Amir al-Mu'mineen عليه الصلاة والسلام by cussing. And he also verbally abused عمار. فقالت عائشة, عائشة said, أما علي عليه السلام فلست قائلة لك فيها شيئا. As far as علي سلام الله عليه وروحه له الفداء is concerned, I'm not going to say anything to you. This person has just cussed أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام. And عائشة says, I'm not going to say anything. وأما عمار, but as far as عمار is concerned, فإني سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يقول, I heard رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم say, لا يخير بين أمرين إلا اختار أرشدهما. He would not be given the choice of two things, of two ways, except that he would choose the better one, the one that's more guided. That's that which is more correct. So if he's given choice of two options, he will choose that option which is closer to guidance, which is more valid. However, with respect to Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam, I'm not going to say anything. This is the book of Tarikh Madinati Dimashq by Hafiz ibn Asakir, or also commonly known as Tarikh ibn Asakir, volume number 43, Tab'a Dar al-Fikr, published by Dar al-Fikr at the year 1996, page 407. Same hadith that someone in the presence of Aisha cussed Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wassalam, and Aisha said, I'm not going to say anything that you cussed Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wassalam. Salamullahi ala Amir al-Mu'mineen, Salamullahi ala Amir al-Mu'mineen, Salamullahi ala Amir al-Mu'mineen. This is the book of Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Now, if somebody cusses Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wassalam and cusses Ammar ibn Yasir, what is the difference? The difference is, cussing Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam is tantamount, is equal to cussing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And cussing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is cussing Allah and is apostasy. Is apostasy. So that act, which is apostasy, which is al-irtidad, because that is cussing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aisha does not say anything with that regard. However, she has a problem if the person cusses Ammar, Ammar ibn Yasir. Musnad Ahmad ibn Hanbal volume number 44, published by Risala Foundation in year 1421, hadith number 26,748, دخلت على أم سلمة فقالت لي. Abu Abdullah al-Dajjali says, I went to Umm Salama, radiyallahu anha, and she said to me, أَيُسَبُّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ فِيكُمْ. Is it the case that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is cursed and cussed and verbally abused in your locality where you live? قُلْتُ مَعَاذَ اللَّهِ. I said, no, I seek refuge unto Allah, subhanallah. أو كلمة نحوها, or a word like that. قالت, she said, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يقول, I heard رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم say, من سب عليا عليه السلام فقد سبني. Whoever curses أمير المؤمنين عليه الصلاة والسلام, he curses me. Whoever abuses أمير المؤمنين عليه الصلاة والسلام verbally, he has verbally abused me. إسناده صحيح. This hadith is صحيح, as you see. Now, this hadith indicates that in Islamic lands, it was common that Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam was verbally abused and verbally condemned, and he was verbally disrespected and cussed. And that's why Umm Salama says that you, are you people cussing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam? Because cussing Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam is equal to cussing Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam. If Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam was not cussed, then it would not be right for Umm Salama to say such a thing. Fadail al-Sahaba by Ahmad ibn Muhammad ibn Hanbal, published by Dar ibn al-Jawzi. This book has been verified and researched by Wasiullah ibn Muhammad Abbas, professor of hadith and Umm al-Qura University in Mecca, published in year 1999. Hadith number 1011, إسناده صحيح. قالت, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم يقول, من سب عليا عليه السلام فقد سبني. Whoever uses bad language with respect to أمير المؤمنين عليه الصلاة والسلام, whoever badmouths أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام, whoever swears at أمير المؤمنين عليه الصلاة والسلام, he has badmouthed me, he has sworn at me, and he has blasphemed me. صلى الله عليه وسلم. كتاب المستدرك على الصحيحين للحاكم النيسابوري, volume number 3, published by Darul Fikr, year 1430, page number 334, hadith number 4673. أم سلمة says, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول, I heard the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم say, من سب عليا عليه السلام فقد سبني. Whoever badmouths and blasphemes and swears at Amir al-Mu'minin عليه الصلاة والسلام, he indeed has blasphemed me and he has sworn at me. And with regard to hadith 4673, look at the footnote. Says Zahabi, Al-Zahabi says, in Talkhis al-Mustadrak, sahih. He has also agreed that this hadith is sahih. And with respect to the next hadith, 4674, the narrator says that I was young and I went to Medina and I went to see Umm Salama. I heard Umm Salama say, Ya Shabib ibn Rub'i, fa'ajabaha rajulun jalfun jaf, labbayka ya amata. He said, Shabib ibn Rub'i, a man who was very aggressive and a man who was very coarse, responded, yes, mother. قالت, يسب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم في ناديكم. Is it the case that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم is sworn at, is blasphemed, is bad-mouthed in your courts? قلت وأنا ذلك. He said that, no, how is that possible that we would, in our associations, in our socializations, we would blaspheme and swear at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Qalat fa'ali ibn Abi Talibin salamullah alayhi. He said, isn't this the case about Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, that you blaspheme him, that you in your sessions, in your courts, in your socializations, you badmouth Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam and use bad language about him? قال إنا لنقول أشياء نريد عرض الدنيا. He said that we say things and for the purpose of getting worldly materials, for reaching our worldly purposes, objectives. قالت فإني سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول. I heard رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم say, من سب عليا عليه السلام فقد سبني. Whoever blasphemes Amir al-Mu'mineen عليه السلام and badmouths him, he has badmouthed me. وَمَنْ سَبَّنِي فَقَدْ سَبَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى. And whoever curses at me, swears at me, badmouths me, he has sworn at Allah, he has blasphemed Allah, he has badmouthed Allah تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى. And this hadith, the second hadith, has been also verified to be sahih by Al-Manawi, famous and respected Umari scholar of hadith, Al-Manawi, Abdul Ra'uf Al-Manawi, in his book, Al-Kitab Al-Taysir, Bisharh Al-Jami' Al-Saghir, page number 422. من سب عليا أي علي بن أبي طالب عليه السلام فقد سبني أي فكأنه سبني ومن سبني فقد سب الله ومن سب الله فهو أعظم الأشقياء رواه حاكم في المستدرك عن أم سلمة رضي الله عنها وإسناده صحيح. Whoever curses Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam, he has cursed me. And whoever curses me, he has cursed Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. When whoever curses Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he is the worst degenerate in the world. This hadith is sahih. Faydhul Qadir, Sharh al-Jami' al-Saghir, Ta'alifu, Abdul Ra'uf al-Manawi, volume number 6, published by Darul Ma'rifah in 1972. Again, this, he says, look, hadith number 8736, sah, means this is a code for the hadith being sahih, a symbol for siha. So that hadith is sahih. من سب علي بن أبي طالب عليه السلام فقد سبني ومن سبني فقد سب الله. Whoever curses Amir al-Mu'mineen عليه السلام, he has cursed me. And whoever curses me, he has cursed Allah. ومن سب الله فهو أعظم الأشقياء. And whoever curses Allah, he is the worst degenerate. وفيه إشارة إلى كمال الاتحاد بين المصطفى والمرتضى سلام الله عليهما وآلهما. This hadith indicates extreme unity, extreme oneness between Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم and المرتضى أمير المؤمنين عليه الصلاة والسلام. بحيث because أن محبة الواحد توجب محبة الآخر وبغضه يوجب بغضه. Because loving one of them pre-requires loving the other, and hating one of them requires to hate the other and presupposes the hate of the other. So they are uniquely one. Kitab al-Sunan al-Kubra by Ahmad ibn Shu'aib al-Nisa'i, volume number 7, published by Muassas al-Risala in year 1421. Page 441, chapter 20, Man sabba aliyan alayhi salam faqad sabbani, hadith number 8422. Same thing, man sabba aliyan alayhi salam faqad sabbani. Whoever curses Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wa salam, he has cursed me. Majma'u al-Zawaid fi tahqiq manba'ul. Majma'u al-Zawaid wa manba'ul fawaid by Abu Bakr al-Haythami, volume number 9, published by Darul Fikr, published in the year 1994, page number 175, hadith number 14,470. Man sabba aliyan alayhi salam faqad sabbani. This hadith has been narrated by Ahmad ibn Hanbal. And all of its narrators are narrators of Bukhari and Muslim, except Abu Abdullah al-Dajjali in his thiqa. So this hadith is extremely reliable in Sahih hadith, that whoever curses Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, he has cursed Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the gravity of cursing Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wa salam and swearing at Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam and bad-mouthing him is extreme, and it's apostasy. It's apostasy. And Aisha is okay with that. He doesn't object to that. And that could be only true if she is an enemy of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wassalam. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi at-tahirin wal la'nu ala a'da'ihim min al-ana ila abad al-abidin.